In this video, we're going to be using a combination of photos, topographic maps, to study landforms and landscapes shaped by stream erosion and deposition. There are a couple of interesting types of river and stream channels. The first is a meandering channel. Here you have one single channel that migrates or meanders back and forth across a relatively flat floodplain by eroding on the outside of the bends and depositing on the inside of the bends. Such a channel type develops on a stream that has a relatively flat or gentle gradient and carries predominantly a fine sediment load. The other channel type is called the braided channel. This occurs where the river or stream channels split apart and rejoin. You have multiple interconnected channels, splitting and rejoining, splitting and rejoining. This occurs when the stream carries a coarse sediment load and has a variable discharge. For example, streams that carry glacial meltwater. The melting of the glacier ice delivers lots of coarse sediment, creates a discharge that's highly variable. More meltwater is produced in summer than in winter. And so having multiple interconnected channels is a way for such a stream to carry more of that coarse sediment as bed load. This photo shows the Willamette River near the small town of Peoria, which is in between Corvallis and Eugene. Today, the Willamette River has elements of a meandering stream. You can see that we have much of the water flowing in a single channel. We have a number of sinuous bends to that channel. There's going to be erosion on the outside of those bends where the velocity is faster, and deposition on the inside of the bends where velocity is slower. So over time, the channel is going to move in the outside direction. But the Willamette River also shows elements of a braided channel as well. This is because during the Ice Age, there was significant glacier ice in the upper part of the Willamette Basin in the Cascades, and those glaciers delivered lots of coarse sediment to the Willamette River and its tributaries. We can see a number of other smaller channels here. Some of these date to the time when the Willamette River had a more braided channel morphology. These other channels may actually be oxbow lakes or cutoff meanders that formed in more modern times as the Willamette developed a more meandering character that it has today. This is a topographic map of the same area shown in the previous photo. Here's the town of Peoria up here. The Willamette River flows from south to north. And we can tell that by looking at the elevations of the land surface. For example, 269 feet down here, 258 feet up here. So down would be in this direction. Of course, water flows downhill, and so the river is flowing from south to north. We see that Willamette has a single large channel, but also several smaller channels that split off and then rejoin with the main channel, reflecting its earlier braided morphology that the Willamette had during the Ice Age. Now it has a more meander-like characteristic. This is because the Willamette River's when it's where it flows through the Willamette Valley is mostly flowing across a landscape that's relatively flat. There's a very slight slope or small gradient. And this is a situation where a meandering channel morphology develops. In the distance between Eugene and Portland, 100 or so miles, the river drops only 200 feet. That's a pretty flat gradient, about 2 feet per mile. And for that reason, the river takes on meandering characteristics. How do meanders work? Well, we're going to simultaneously erode on the outside of the bend while depositing on the inside of the bend. This is because where the water flows around a bend, the velocity varies across the width of the channel. High velocity on the outside of the bend, low velocity on the inside of the bend. Because of that distribution of velocity across the channel, we get deposition on the inside of the bend and erosion on the outside of the bend. So over time, the channel meanders or migrates in the outward direction. So each of these meander loops is going to move in the directions indicated. The Willamette River is also terraced. Terraces occur when there's a change in the river's sediment load or discharge, causing it to erode downward and abandon its older, higher floodplain. But what do terraces look like? They occur when the landscape has a stairstep-like appearance, where you have an abrupt vertical change to the ground elevation. What would this look like in terms of contours on a topographic map? Well, we'd see an area of widely spaced contours, and then an area where the contours are more closely spaced, and then another area of widely spaced contours, reflecting ground that's flatter, becoming steeper, and then flatter again. So to find river terraces, we're looking for an area of tightly spaced contours in an area of otherwise widely spaced contours. And we see a river terrace running here alongside Peoria Road. In other words, Peoria Road runs along the top of one of the terraces along the Willamette River. We see closely spaced contours here, widely spaced contours here and here. Flatter ground, steeper ground, and then flatter ground again. Again, terraces form when the river's discharge or sediment load changes. As we went from an ice age climate into the warmer climate that we have today, that of course changed precipitation patterns, it changed the amount of glacier ice cover in the Cascades, and so the Willamette River and its tributaries, their discharge and sediment load changed during that transition from the ice age climate to the modern climate. That caused the river to cut downward into the landscape and abandon its higher, older floodplain. The modern floodplain is the lower ground along the river channel inside of those terraces. We'd probably expect to see another a paired terrace off here on the other side. On the other side of the river. This aerial photograph shows a section of the Mississippi River along the Mississippi-Louisiana border. Mississippi River is a classic meandering stream. It's flowing across a very flat landscape. The position of the channel changes over time as it erodes on the outside of the bends and deposits on the inside of the bends. Of course, the river's flowing in this direction, north to south. The velocity is high on the outside of the bends, low on the inside of the bends. You can see sediment being deposited on the inner side of these river bends, while we have erosion on the outside of the bends. As a result, over time, each of these bends is migrating in the outward direction. migrating or meandering in the outside direction. Where adjacent meander bends erode into each other, we can form an oxbow lake, a cut-off meander loop. What happened here is the river channel once followed a path, something like this. Eroding on the outside of the bends meant that these meanders were moving towards each other over time. Eventually, they eroded into each other. When that happened, the river abandoned that meander loop and took a shorter, straighter path. The abandoned portion of the meander loop remains as an oxbow lake. This is a topographic map showing the same area in the previous aerial photo. Oxbow Lake, an abandoned meander loop formed when adjacent meanders eroded into each other. These contours represent former locations of the channel banks as the channel meandered across the surface. When a flood occurs and water pours out of the channel, it immediately loses velocity. That causes sediment to deposit along the channel banks, forming slightly elevated ground, elevated enough that it shows up in the contours on these topogra on a topographic map. These features are called meander scars. They provide a record of the channel's migration or meandering over time.